Okay, this is one that I recommend you turn into an MP3 and listen to because it's got quite a lot of sentence segments that you may well be able to use. So hopefully if you play it to yourself before the exam, it should be of use. General tips then. First of all, in both of the responses for the lip paper plan, so you don't waste time and you're actually coming into the exam. With the actual text in the book, I have actually heard it, some students actually fold, tiny, tiny fold in the corner of the book, so and then they close the book and leave it pressed so that obviously it's just notable which pages have been turned over in the exam. That's obviously not really cheating, it's just an easier way than having to remember the numbers. But obviously, if you can remember the numbers and the pages are where the quotes are easily, then obviously you won't need to do that. It's up to you. Spend more time on the poetry because it's worth 3/5 of the marks, and make sure the whole way through you're using detailed vocabulary. So we look then at the poetry section. Now you're going to have a question where you're going to have to answer two, sorry. You're going to have to answer with reference to two of the modern poems and two of the old poems, depending on which cluster you've done. Mention a range of smile points, whatever you do. So the subject, the meaning, the images, the language, and the effect, pick them out. Cross-reference a lot, as much as you can. Use the question prompt as the first thing you mention. Okay, so basically, whatever the question says, it's on language, it's on feelings, it's on emotions, on anger, you answer that first. That's how you start talking about it. And then you can talk about how the other piles support that, or how whatever is mentioned, the question is supported by it. So an example of that would be if the question is along the lines of how are images used in, obviously the focus there is we're looking at the idea of images. So you'd write a point evidence explain point, and then you'd add anything as following. So so you'd write your PE, and then you'd say this helps us understand the, and then you might say it helps us understand the language used. This gives us a better idea of the other meanings behind the poem, which ultimately makes clearer the structure is used because, etc., etc., etc. So basically, what you're looking at here is your PE point, and you'll say the use of imagery, which is the eye, helps us to understand the depth of her revenge by, and then obviously whatever you want to do about it. Now, if the question is flipped, so it's actually looking more at being supported by rather than supporting, if the question then would be along the lines of how does the writer convey a sense of revenge? So basically, here you've got the meaning, and it's asking you how is everything else getting it across in the meaning? How is the image and language and structure helping us understand this meaning section? So again, you write a point evidence explain point, and then you add the following as relevant. So you can say this is further enhanced by, and mention something from Smile. In addition, the helps us to, again, something from Smile, and this is accentuated by which da, 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 da. So for example, again, for that question, how does the writer convey a sense of revenge? I've got my PE point, the depth of her revenge, PE, and this is further enhanced with the image of, and then I've talked about I, and then obviously I could keep doing that, doing that, doing that. Okay, hopefully that was useful. Moving on, do not pick out dozens of the same thing. Okay, if you've picked out one or two alliterations, that is it. You don't need to pick out all seven. You want to show that you understand several themes, several languages, several words, several images, and several uses of structure. That's really important that you get the range there so you've understood all the ways which the writer has tried to get the message across. And always mention the effect of what you're picking out. So you want to say things like, allows us to imagine more clearly, emphasize the feelings the poet has, makes us stop and consider before moving on. You might just want to put any of these words or any of these phrases into a thesaurus. Obviously, I'm not going to teach you how to use Google, that would be patronizing. But obviously, if you Google like makes or etc., etc., you might find words like exemplifies, typifies, extenuates. All those high level words will obviously be good for you to use and just regurgitating these sentences somehow. I'll also mention what you think and attempt something original. Okay, so get to mentioning what you actually think. It makes me think about, that's always good. And then try and actually mention something original. Now, even if you're wrong, that's not a problem, but make sure that you've put in the classical understandings first. And then when you come to put in what you think is original, always quantify it with a kind of vague, kind of guarded introduction. So that could be another meaning, could be some argue this also shows, perhaps this indicates something like that. Something just kind of like, you know, that I also know this, but I'm just saying it. I'm not 100% behind it. Because if you go in like on a full preacher mode, no, this definitely means this, 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 and it's wrong, then obviously that's not going to be very beneficial when the examiner's looking at it, because he'll just think that you haven't actually understand the basics of the poem. And if you get that wrong, then he can't give you the C grade marks, and he can't be giving you A grade marks if he hasn't given you C grade marks. So now all that's left, hopefully, for poetry is looking at how to structure an answer. So for the question with four poems, the good thing about that is that you can bury a poem that you don't know very well. So basically, you'll just mention it at the end. So if you look at this little detail we have here, then imagine the colours were all different analyses. Excuse me, if you imagine each of the colours was analysis of a paragraph. So the red here is poem one, and you've got that much. The green is poem two, and you've got a similar amount. You've got a little less for poem three, and then poem four is just like this annexed line at the bottom, but it's still compared it to, so you'd say, we see this in one, similarly in two we see, however in three, da-da-da-da-da-da, but four also has dang. And then you can just put the end of that in there. So basically, you'll have written your paragraph, which develops all the other poem's interpretations, and then simply add at the end, this is also seen in, etc., with a smart point. Now, obviously, the linking, comparing and contrasting is going to be important. So comparing, okay, so anywhere between these junctions where the colors actually meet, if this is how you're choosing to plan it, then you're going to say, we also see this is echoed in, which is further represented through, and again, this is obvious in, it is prevalent to in, which also occurs in, etc., 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 and you've got your variation there. You probably want to get four contrasts and four similarities at least through your essay, and that'll probably be B-worthy. Obviously, the more, the better. For contrasting language, then, you can say, however, in, or the opposite, though, can be seen. Another perspective can be seen through. On the other hand, this is in stark contrast to, which totally differs from, etc., etc., etc. So there you're looking at similarities and differences. And obviously, you'll have 100 of your own. Feel free to use them. Now, some points will be similar and different at the same time. So there'll be a similar theme, say maybe of love in two poems, but one might be for a family member and one might be for a lover. So mention that the theme is the same, but obviously shown through a different facet. That's a really easy way to compare and contrast. Now, you can do the above mentioned with the four all in one paragraph, or there's another way of doing it, which not many people do, but obviously it might suit your style. Choose to write the several paragraphs, or write an analysis of poem one, in your first section. Then in the next section that you're writing about, just say about how poem two is similar or different, a couple of points, and the next one about how three is similar or different to one and two, again just a couple of points, and the last section write about being four similar or different to one, two, three. Obviously, if you're just doing the two-part question, then you're just going to compare the poems equally, 4 or 5 points each all the way through. Now, a lot of the contrasting language and the sentence segments that I've given you can actually be used again in the text, so obviously I'm not going to repeat them. The most important thing you remember for whichever text you're doing, again, is plan your answer to save your time going blank. You don't want to go blank in the middle and try and sit there thinking halfway through, well, where was I going with this? If you've got 4 or 5 points written at the top, you know where you're going. Okay, always offer 4 points answering the question. So if you look over the videos that we've done already for the text that we have managed to do, then you'll pick up at least several for each question. Obviously, you should know them from your revision, hopefully. Try to focus on something called slack, which is basically looking at a character's speech, the language of description that the writer uses, so maybe in his height or his size or what he's compared to, the actions that they do, so obviously swinging their arms, etc., or fighting or whatever it is they do, the way they move perhaps, and then pick up other character comments. So most obvious one is how everyone talks about Curly and Of Mice and Men. Everyone's always bad mouthing her, which gives us a lot of information about her. And obviously looking at those four aspects will allow you to show that you understand the different ways the writer's getting his message across. Write PEE points for each thing that you mention, and then add any of the following as appropriate. Now, the ones where I say important, obviously they're the ones that you must include if you're looking to get higher than a B, and the others are really, they're relevant and I would recommend doing them, but the very important ones are the ones you need for at least a B. Okay, so you need detailed language analysis of words and symbolism. Okay, try and do that every possible opportunity. That's very, very important. You need to cross-reference to other points in the book to show how change has occurred. That's very, very important. You need to cross-reference to other characters where relevant, and obviously in that you can also mention social historical context. You need to link to other similar or relevant literature, obviously if you know it, but it's not essential. You need to show the writer's intention always. What were they saying about the time? What were they saying about the people? What were they saying about everything? And that's very, very important. And you always need to mention the effect that everything would actually have on the reader. Again, that's incredibly important. So all those four, make sure sure the symbolism analysis, the cross-references, writer's intentions and effect on reader, make sure you mention them as much as you can in each of your points. Now, all of this is actually covered in detail in the third and fourth videos that we actually have done. They're called Essay Writing 3 of 7 and 4 of 7, and it goes through PE in detail with lots of examples.